So, we continue our discussion on marginal decision making. So in the end, yes, the student does not choose to say, I study 24 hours and I don't do anything else. That's not what we see people do. Okay, I'll say, it's often a question of, shall I spend the next hour studying? Or, shall I spend the next hour going to watch a movie or going out to watch a football match or chatting with my friends, you know? So often, people have plans and then they make decisions at the margins of those plans, right? A company producing a particular product incorporates marginal decision making. For example, what would it cost me to produce the next item, right? And then when we look at this idea of marginal decision making and together with rationality, we see that we should only take actions whose benefits exceed the cost, right? And in terms of marginal cost and benefits, we should only take an action if the extra benefits we are going to get for taking that action. Say, for example, we should study more if the benefit of studying exceeds, say, for example, our best alternative if we were not studying would have been watching a movie. We'll compare that extra hour I'm going to study. I compare it with the extra hour I'm going to watch a movie. What is more beneficial? Standard rationality assumption tells us we should take an action only if the benefit exceeds the cost. Okay? So these things really shape so much of economic analysis as we go forward. Okay? Right. So, and then the third assumption. Okay, so fine, in terms of how people make decisions, so we say yes, people, the principles of economics, people face trade-offs. Second, we say people face opportunity costs, so they have to give up something to get another. In fact, the idea of opportunity cost is that of, to get something, the cost of something is what you give up to get it, right? And then we look at marginal decision-making, that people do not choose to say, I do one activity. Do I sleep whole day or do I study whole day? No. Should I spend the extra hour sleeping? Should I spend the extra hour studying? People should make decisions at the margin of their current plans. And then we look at the fourth idea, which is incentives matter, right? What is an incentive? Well, an incentive is basically a reward or a penalty that will affect your decision making, that will affect the choice you make. Okay? Incentives matter because in choosing, in rational people who consider all available information before making their decisions, in making their choices, they have to consider incentives. What rewards they get, what punishments or penalties they get. Okay, you see this in every area of, in so many areas of economics. Say, for example, in taxation, if I am a worker who is earning a particular amount of money, I know I have a responsibility to pay a tax, right? My income tax. Often in studies, we see people have to look in declaring my tax. Should I say the truth or should I lie? In making these sorts of decisions, in trying to choose between alternative actions, rational individuals will choose what will be the benefit of lying in this case. What will be the benefit if I take this action? The cost of this action and the benefit I will get. People weigh these things. Okay? If I am caught, what will be the punishment? If I am not caught, what will be the reward? So people often think about incentives, okay, in deciding what actions to take, right? And then we look at okay, so I think we can now move on to talk about, yes, the basic assumptions in economics are that people are rational, so basically mistakes do not happen, right? Rational individuals, the basis of economic analysis, at least standard economics, is that people think through all available information before making their decisions, right? And in fact, this also happens to be the most, the key criticism of economics, right? Which gives rise to the study of behavioral economics, which sees where this assumption does not hold, okay? We see that people are risk averse. People don't like taking risks, for example. It has been seen that people are afraid of losing something twice as much as gaining that same thing, right? So we see people also, and there have been many ideas, like Daniel Kahneman is one economist, he won the Nobel Prize for economics on this field of behavioral economics, BEC, right? So sometimes this idea of rationality does not work, okay? You do not always take account of all information before making a decision. So what do people do? There have been many options that have been explained. So bounded rationality. So what people end up doing is that they say, okay, this is a basic rule of thumb, call them heuristics. Okay, heuristics. So people say, I'm going to, this is my way of doing this. Okay, they choose simple rules of deciding. When I earn my monthly salary, this is what I'm going to do. When I'm faced with this particular economic situation, this is what I'm going to do. So people execute this same simple rule until when that rule does not work, then they have to change it. Because there is a high cost in obtaining information. You don't want to say every time you are faced with anytime you are paid at the end of the month, you have to sit down and go through all calculations you have to make. No, people simplify the process by having a particular simple rules of how they approach economic decision making. Okay, they execute these simple rules until these rules do not work, and then they incur extra cost in thinking through again how they should approach their decision making. Right? So sometimes, yes, rationality does not explain accurately the behavior of people we see. Okay, that being especially in terms of one book I was reading, Thinking Fast and Thinking Slow, I've forgotten the author, was basically an idea on this behavioral economics, looking at our human economic decision making, how we consider it. Our decision making is very flawed. Our tunnel vision, we tend to be risk averse, like we are talking, and what else? This idea of we tend to take decisions, we trust the things we see most often. Okay, this also is an idea on this bounded rationality, right? So, what is familiar, basically? Okay, the exposure, exactly. So it's a repeated exposure bias. So what we have been exposed to most often tends to influence our decision making. So you have to be asking yourself, am I taking this decision because this is the type of thinking I'm being exposed to, or this is the right thing to do, which of course you have to follow rules of logic and think through things like that, right? So yes, bounded rationality, nudge theory, nudge. So this is the idea of like using psychological reinforcement. There was one experiment they did of telling people that if they do not pay, for example, they have a debt or something to pay tax, they wrote them a general letter that they sent to everybody that they should pay their fee and things like that. And then they sent another letter, okay, which was a personalized letter to that exact person, putting, okay, yes, this was an issue of a car, right? So then they put the picture of the car in question, the car that they would seize or take action on if the person does not pay. When they sent the personalized letter, people reacted three times more than they did when they were sent a generic letter. So this is psychological, the nudge theory, psychological reinforcement. Okay. So bounded rationality, nudge theory. What else? There was one other. Behavioral economics is what comes to save the day, where rationality does not explain accurately human behavior that we observe. Okay, so now let us look at economics as a science. Right, like I said before, we don't put people in test tubes and heat them up to see their preferences or their decisions they will make. What we do, we follow the idea of economics being a science depends on the method of analysis, okay, not the subject matter. What we study in economics is human behavior, but the method in which we study this economics is what is similar to that used by scientists, okay? For example, a scientist might want to study the effects of sunlight on the growth of a plant, okay? Of a plant. How does he go about this process, right? This actually is similar. We look at how does the price of a good affect the quantity of that good that consumers are willing to buy, okay? In fact, this is the key theory in economics. The higher the price, the lower the quantity demanded, right? The law of demand. So, and of course, the neighboring law of supply, the higher the price, the higher the quantity that suppliers are willing to supply of that particular good. So, in saying this, someone has to, you must have gone through the scientific method. Okay, maybe someone sat one day and observed that throughout these the past few months, or having looked at people, that whenever the price of something rises, people tend to buy less of that particular good. Say this is someone selling oranges. Whenever I raise the price of oranges, people tend to buy less of the orange. So maybe what I'll do, I have had this observation, right? This is asking questions. I first of all ask myself, why is this thing happening? How is it happening? I ask myself various questions based on what I have seen to observe about the price of oranges, right? And then, in asking this question, I'll come to my hypothesis. Like, this is a guess. An hypothesis is basically a guess based on what we have observed, okay? I say, okay, looking at what I have seen and the questions I've asked, I make an educated guess. I'm a trader, of course, I've been selling, I know things that could affect. I say, well, this could be, this is probably the price that is affecting this quantity that people are buying, right? And then the next thing the trader will do is to set up an experiment, right? In setting up the experiment, we have to consider a dependent variable and an independent variable, okay? An independent variable is also called an endogenous variable. It is what we determine within